Rapid advancements in artificial intelligence continue as companies roll out new products, sparking both wonder and concern. Over the past week, OpenAI unveiled its next-generation chatbot, or ChatGPT 4.0. The new AI assistant can respond to voice, text, and visual commands in real time, as in this presentation when engineers asked it to tell a bedtime story.
Oh, a bedtime story about robots and love? I got you covered. Gather round, Barrett. Once upon a time.
I really want maximal emotion, like maximal expressiveness, much more than you were doing before.
Understood. Let's amplify the drama. Once upon a time.
Can you do this in a robotic voice now?
Initiating dramatic robotic voice. Once upon a time.
OpenAI actually paused the use of that particular virtual voice after some pointed out its similarity to the robot voiced by Scarlett Johansson in the movie Her.
Good morning, Theodore.
Good morning.
You have a meeting in 5 minutes. You want to try getting out of bed?
You're too funny.
Okay, good. I'm funny. I want to learn everything about everything.
Google also unveiled a new AI-powered search function this week. For more on that and all these developments, we're joined by Nilay Patel, editor-in-chief of The Verge and host of the Decoder podcast. So, Nilay, let's just start with Google, the most visited website in the world. It's making major changes to how billions of people search the web. Users will now see an AI-generated answer for their search. How big a deal is that?
It's a momentous change for how the web works today. A lot of websites that you visit are driven by the need for Google traffic. It's up to 30% or more of most big websites' traffic comes from Google. So when Google starts keeping more of that traffic for itself, that's going to change the economics of putting content on the web. It might shift some of that content to platforms like TikTok and YouTube and Instagram. And it will certainly shake up how the web is organized and structured. Because instead of getting links from Google, publishers might try to game their way into those AI previews. And I think Google has a big question to answer around what the incentive to put new content on the web is if it's just going to synthesize that content and present it to people searching for free. Yeah. I talked to Google CEO Sundar Pichai about this. He said it's a paradigm shift. There's going to be changes, but he believes the web will endure.
You described the reaction to the news of this new search from people who actually make websites as fundamentally apocalyptic. Why?
Yeah, I mean, the web has reached a steady state over the past 25, 30 years where, people put up websites, Google indexes those websites. We allow Google to do that because that's what's considered fair use. And then in return, Google sends traffic to websites. And it's a huge portion of traffic for a lot of the websites on the internet is Google search traffic. If Google starts to keep that traffic for themselves, then a lot of businesses will fail.
Okay, what about this new chatbot that ChatGPT that OpenAI just revealed? We saw a brief demo of that. Is this basically the model for how all of us are going to be interacting with our tech one day?
It's the vision. Google unveiled something that's very similar to it called Project Astra, this idea that you have a multimodal search interface where you've got your phone in your hand, your phone is looking at things with its camera, it's talking to you about what it sees, you can ask it questions, it has a personality. OpenAI is really leaning into the personality factor here. What we haven't seen is a huge leap in terms of accuracy. So because the chatbots are very good at language, that you can build these products that are very convincing, right? They can talk to you, that have these personalities, that can emote in different ways, that can do different kinds of image generation, that can recognize videos of broken toys in your home and tell you how to fix them. The flip side of it is language and intelligence aren't 100% correlated, maybe not at all correlated. And so you're seeing this gap of the demos where you ask it questions and it's very confident in what it tells you, but sometimes it's wrong. And I think that's actually the thing that's going to hold these kinds of products back from widespread adoption, is they've got to get better at being accurate. I think we're seeing incredible advances in facility with language, and we're seeing a pretty steady state in terms of actual intelligence.
Meanwhile, Microsoft, we should mention, is also going to make its own big AI announcement this week. What do we expect to hear from them?
So today, Microsoft unveiled a new line of AI PCs, Copilot PCs. That's what they're branding them as. They've got a new chip in them, which they claim will be faster than the chip in Apple's MacBook Air. That has been a benchmark for the industry for a very long time. And they're rolling out a new version of Windows that has a bunch of AI features built into it for consumers, including one called Recall, which is fascinating, where the operating system, or Windows, basically watches along with you as you use your computer. You can ask it questions as you're playing games. It can talk to you about what it's seeing on the screen in the game. You can ask it questions for help in the games. As you're using the applications on your PC, you can ask it for help. It can drive your PC for you. This is a big vision for in computing. It's been the dream for a long time. You'll have an intelligent agent on your computer that is actually helping you use that computer. Microsoft took the first steps of that today with the Copilot PCs. It seems very compelling. I have a lot of questions about privacy and security and where all that data is going and who's tracking and who has access to it. Microsoft says it's all being done locally on the PC, but I really want to test this stuff out and make sure that that's actually true.
You mentioned privacy, security concerns, also accuracy concerns with some of the other AI functions. I guess the question is, how much insight do you have as someone who covers this into where all of those concerns rank in terms of how quickly some of these tech firms are pushing out new products? Is that a shared concern?
I don't think that concern ranks nearly highly enough. I think what you're seeing here is an extraordinary battle between a bunch of big tech companies who feel the competitive pressure for the first time in a long time from OpenAI, from one another, and they're racing these products out to capture market share so they don't get left behind. You know, just a few weeks, you know, Apple's gonna roll out a bunch of AI features in the new version of the iOS for the iPhone, and we'll see them partner with a Google or an OpenAI for some of the features in a way that might cut against some of their privacy promises. We have to see what they claim. And that is all because of the pressure that this is a paradigm shift on the order of mobile, on the order of social networking. And if you get left behind, you're going to lose a ton of market share.
That is Nilay Patel, editor-in-chief of The Verge and host of the Decoder podcast. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thanks for having me.
As Donald